In 1979, the armed forces of the Soviet Union entered Afghanistan to prop up its fledgling communist government. What ensued was a decade-long war that went on to become one of the most drug-induced conflicts in human history. On December the 27th, 1979, 25 men from the Spetsnaz group called Grom, or Thunder, along with some men from the KGB, stormed the Tajburg Palace in Kabul. This was the home of Afghanistan's leader, Hafizullah Amin. Amin had only been in power since September of that year, but already his short rule had contravened Soviet interests in this key country that sat on the Soviet Union's southern border. He had caused upheaval in communist control of Afghanistan by purging the Communist Party of key Soviet allies. He was himself closely allied to Islamic fundamentalists throughout Afghanistan. Some among the Soviet leadership even thought Amin to be secretly allied with the US and China, working to undermine Soviet interests in the region. The elite Soviet soldiers that stormed the Tajburg Palace in Kabul captured Amin alive. Soon after, however, he was put to death in a so-called revolutionary trial for crimes against the state. Babrak Karmal, an exiled leader of the Marxist People's Democratic Party of Afghanistan, was installed by the Soviets as the head of the government. On Christmas Eve 1979, this alleged revolution was supported by a full invasion from the Soviet Union. Soviet paratroopers dropped into Kabul and its environs, taking control of key locations and power supplies. An estimated 280 transport planes, with three divisions of 8,500 men, arrived to further consolidate Soviet military presence in the capital. But this show of force by the Soviet Union in Afghanistan was not enough to control the country. Outside of Kabul, Soviet troops were met with fierce resistance. Afghan locals rallied against this foreign atheistic invader. Opposition manifested itself most strongly in the Mujahideen, an Islamic paramilitary group that used guerrilla tactics to harass Soviet forces before disappearing into the Afghan mountains. The situation for the Soviets worsened. The Mujahideen gained financial and military support from the USA, including such hardware as Stinger missile launchers in 1987, allowing the Mujahideen soldiers to shoot down Soviet planes and helicopters with ease. Soviet troop presence in Afghanistan began to increase. The 30,000 Soviet soldiers that had entered Afghanistan in 1979 rose to 100,000 by the end of 1980. By 1985, an estimated 500,000 Soviet soldiers were committed in this ongoing Afghan-Soviet war. So where do the drugs come in? Let's begin by looking at drug production in Afghanistan on the eve of the Soviet invasion in 1979. First of all, in the 1970s, Afghanistan was not nearly as central to the drug trade as it is today in the 21st century. Afghanistan's subtropical climate, with arid summers and mild winters, did make it ideal for the growth of the poppy, whose milky sap is used for the development of opium. However, in the 70s, the cultivation of poppies was mainly concentrated in the southern and eastern regions of the country, where the climate was best for their production. Actual processing of the sap needed for the opium usually occurred in Afghanistan's neighbours, Iran and Pakistan. The Afghan-Soviet war that erupted in 1979 upended this status quo. Afghanistan quickly became a country riddled with instability, and in many areas, the absence of the rule of law resulted in a boom in the drugs trade. Many Afghan farmers, whose business had previously been in agriculture or the cotton trade, now turned their attention to the more lucrative growth of opium. Use of opium for such purposes had in fact been declared haram or forbidden by several Islamic leaders, but these declarations seem to have mostly been ignored. In 1981, opium production had increased so substantially that its price fell by 20%. Opium production then doubled between 1982 and 1983, resulting in the production of 575 metric tons worth of that powerful poppy sap at the end of that year. Many of the Mujahideen warlords took part in the rapid growth of Afghanistan's opium industry, keeping their processing plants safely across the Afghan border in the more stable Pakistan or Iran. One such leader, a man called Hekmatyar, received aid from both the CIA and Pakistan while building six heroin refineries in southwestern Pakistan. Another leader of the Mujahideen, Nasim Akhundzada, kept an office in Zahedan, Iran, to control drug trafficking out of Afghanistan, What exacerbated this trend of opium production in Afghanistan was in fact a crackdown on the cultivation of poppies inside Pakistan. Throughout the 1980s, the Pakistani government and USAID, the US Agency for International Development, worked to eliminate such practice from the Pakistan-Afghani border. While this may have ended the cultivation of poppies in the area, drug trafficking operations with cultivation taking place inside the Afghan border continued to grow in this period. From 1980 to 1989, thousands of young men from the USSR were to enter Afghanistan where conditions were bad and drugs were cheap. Afghanistan's harsh climate, with extreme heat in the summer and temperatures as low as minus 20 Celsius or minus 4 Fahrenheit in winter, were just one of the many challenges faced by Soviet soldiers in the war. Sanitary conditions and poor equipment among the Soviet army was such that disease spread rapidly and affected a huge number of soldiers. It is estimated that up to 65% of the Soviet army suffered from dysentery, typhoid, hepatitis or pneumonia as the war went on. Harsh conditions were exacerbated by loneliness and boredom. Many soldiers embarked upon a 2-year tour of duty without leave and with minimal contact with their family back home. News of the war was heavily censored in the Soviet Union, meaning that any letters home faced significant redaction by the government censor, or simply didn't make it at all. After the war, many of the war's veterans have spoken of lengthy, meaningless guard duties where very little happened, leading its soldiers to turn to drugs or to alcohol for amusement. Training and morale itself was poor in the Soviet army. Soviet troops were told back at home that they would be welcomed by Afghan civilians with open arms. When they arrived, they soon learned that from that same civilian crowd would emerge their unseen and religiously motivated enemy in the Mujahideen. New Soviet conscripts, boys as young as 17 years old, were picked on in the ritualized hierarchy of the Red Army known as the Devdovshchina. A new arrival in the field of conflict might be expected to give his food ration, equipment from home, or even submit to a beating from his senior. As a result, the 40th Army deployed to Afghanistan contained many soldiers who were said to demonstrate very little commitment to fighting in what became an increasingly unpopular war. It may well seem unsurprising then that many of those serving in the Red Army turned to drugs. "In Afghanistan, drugs were our only amusement," spoke one veteran. "War is miserable without an usher," another confessed. "An usher," meaning marijuana, "helps me to understand Asia." A lot of these words sound similar to the American experience in Vietnam, another Cold War conflict where drugs became front and centre in the soldiers' experience. Details on the US experience in Vietnam, however, are easier to come by. That war was widely reported on in the US media and drew criticism from many within US politics at the time. The Afghan-Soviet war, however, was subject to abject government control by the Soviet Union. In the USSR, all media was state-controlled, and any negative news about the war was strictly censored. Foreign correspondents who were covering the war would have their access to certain areas restricted, and would also have to submit their photos and articles to a censor. Photos of dead or wounded soldiers were banned, as were pictures of destroyed military equipment. News on Soviet soldiers taking drugs then was out of the question. But this began to change with the advent of glasnost, or openness, under Mikhail Gorbachev. In 1989, the investigative journalist Artyom Borovik published the book The Hidden War with the permission of Gorbachev. In the book, Borovik laid out many of the abuses of the Soviet army, including the drug habits of its soldiers in Afghanistan that had plagued the Soviet military throughout the 1980s. Borovik highlighted that the most popular drugs used in the Soviet army in Afghanistan were hashish, marijuana and opium, but also heroin and cocaine. Opium was of course one of the least expensive drugs available in Afghanistan and was consumed in various ways by Soviet soldiers as koknar, an infusion created by boiling poppy heads, or as a very strong tea known as chefir. It became clear that many Russians went into conflict stoned. One soldier commented that drugs were preferable to alcohol because taking a drug was like anaesthetizing your soul. You stop feeling altogether. Hallucinogens also produced undesirable effects, however. Another soldier who smoked hashish before a battle went on to face fearful paranoia in the belief that every bullet had his name on. A Russian major reported that some soldiers got into an hallucinatory state called shubniak, where every bush became a tree and every rock a hill. When they marched, they lifted their feet, he said, twice as high as everyone else. Due to state corruption and poor funding for the Soviet military machine, food was at a premium for the soldiers in Afghanistan. On a combat mission, we didn't eat all day, writes veteran Yuri Tinkov. During the whole time I was in Afghanistan, I got proper food for only a month and a half. The allowance given to Soviet troops, a meagre 10 rubles per month, was mostly spent on the little extra food that was available. Cheap drugs acted to satiate the hunger endured by these soldiers. Additional drug funds were had by ransacking Afghan households and selling off the property of the Soviet state. Fuel was perhaps the easiest thing to sell off to local Afghans. One Russian reported that they sold mostly fuel in Kabul that was supplied to them by the military. However, boots and uniforms were sold too, with the money being used to purchase hashish. In some cases, cars and other military machinery were dismantled, with individual parts, spare or otherwise, being sold off to local Afghans for drugs. More significantly for the war effort, this drug bartering system even included Soviet weaponry. Machine guns, grenade launchers, and the ammunition used to fuel them was sold in a trade that would eventually place these weapons in the hands of the Mujahideen, the very same soldiers who were fighting against the Russians. So extensive was this trade in stolen military hardware that the location where a great deal of it took place in Kabul was known as the Russian Market. As the war drew on, the Soviet state began to recognise that the drug problem had worsened in the Soviet army. In response, the term of service for most Soviet personnel in the mid-80s was reduced from 24 to 9 months. Perhaps this can be likened to the US government's efforts in Vietnam, where US troops would serve only 1 year of service. Nevertheless, as in Vietnam, the war's drug problem did not go away. To make matters worse, many returning troops who had served in Afghanistan went home with their own stash of hashish, opium or heroin. Many of them also bore a new addiction as a result of their service. Another comparison can be drawn here between Afghanistan and Vietnam because, like those Vietnam veterans, many of these soldiers returned home to a country that they felt had abandoned them. By the late 80s, an estimated 46% of Russians were said to have considered the Soviet Union's role in the Afghan-Soviet war as a national disgrace. Only an estimated 1% of the population still voiced support for the war. Veterans of the Afghan-Soviet war were known as Afghansi in the USSR, itself a derogatory term that likened these men to freaks and outcasts. Many veterans returned with their own trauma from their war experience. In 1990, around 40,000 ex-soldiers, 44% of Afghansi living in Moscow, required psychological assistance. Little to none was available to them at this chaotic period in the final days of the Soviet Union. While many of these men may have imagined returning home to the Soviet Union with the same degree of respect afforded to a veteran of World War II, they were left bereft of such recognition by younger Russians. One veteran even reported being likened to a Nazi by a younger man when he returned home. Drug use and addiction in Soviet society had been more or less ignored as an issue by the Soviet state. Such practices were the product of Western capitalist societies, so the message of Soviet propaganda went. As such, drug users in the USSR gained little sympathy, even if they were returning from the harsh war zone of Afghanistan. In 1987, the Soviet government finally recognised that around 175,000 people in the USSR were using psychoactive substances on a regular basis. However, this figure is likely to be much higher, given that the head of the Soviet Criminal Investigation Service later stated in 1990 that 500,000 Soviet citizens were regular drug users. Indeed, evidence suggests that the Soviet state itself had actively participated in the drugs racket in Afghanistan in the 80s. The war had been incredibly expensive for the state. Drugs helped to pay for it. Soviet bombers systematically bombed Afghan cornfields across the country, but conveniently appeared to miss bombing huge crops of poppies. In 1986, Dutch police came across 220 kilograms of heroin that had been hidden in a cargo of raisins from Kabul, Afghanistan. The cargo had been transported across the Soviet Union and had arrived in a Soviet ship. In 1988, 3.5 tons of hashish was intercepted in London, having come by sea from Leningrad in the USSR. Although official figures are of course hard to come by, it seems highly unlikely that the Soviet government would have remained ignorant about such valuable goods crossing their borders and being loaded in their ports. The Afghan-Soviet war came to an end in 1989 when the last Soviet soldiers pulled out of Kabul. The war had seen 9 years of brutal conflict that had failed to preserve the communist government that the Soviets had been so eager to prop up in 1980. Instead, that violent decade had transformed Afghanistan into the opium and heroin capital of the world. As many Afghan refugees returned to their war-torn country, many turned to growing poppies to make a fast buck. In 1991, 4.6 thousand tons of opium were produced in Afghanistan. Today, it is estimated that around 90% of opium production begins its life in Afghanistan. Following the Cold War, the US too withdrew investment in the Mujahideen. The US was of course to return in 2001 to fight the Taliban, an Islamic militant group that had arisen out of that same organisation America had funded in the Cold War. As for the Soviet Union, its long and expensive involvement in the Afghan-Soviet War was one of the reasons that led to the eventual collapse of the USSR in 1991. The Red Army and its involvement in the Afghan-Soviet War became addicted to the drugs of Afghanistan. The nation of Afghanistan itself, as a result of that same Soviet invasion, gained a drug addiction which is still with it to this very day. Thank you very much for watching this episode of the History Chronicles. I hope you've enjoyed it. Please do like, subscribe, and support us on Patreon if you are able. I'll see you again for some more history.